Hi there. How you doing?
I'm well. I will tell you that we just this afternoon we locked the final film of our lineup. So we now have a complete lineup for the fest. And it was a big one, and we're really excited about it. So
So harder this year or the same?
harder, I would say. Some things are a little bit easier, but we shrunk our lineup to 16 features. And so it's just harder because you're making really difficult choices between films. And there weren't really less films, although I will say that there were some kind of interesting ripples in the film release continuum that definitely are playing out in what festivals program and what's available. So
So was there a particular reason to shorten to limit the festival more in those circumstances?
for us, yes. So we're doing a live fest. We will be one of the first major outdoor live festivals. Because of that, and because we can't afford, $500,000 LED screens, all our films are shown at night. So we have four outdoor screens plus a drive-in, and we added a day to the fest. So we have 25 screening slots basically for the live fest. So that was a major limiting factor. And then our online fest, which we're calling Teleported True False, is, I would say, almost everywhere that any other festival has sort of zigged online, we are zagging. We're just doing a very different thing and a very big experiment.
So can you say, tell more about what the difference is?
So, we started a year ago looking at how people were moving online for screenings and how people were handling online viewing.
And
And
I will
very
say that I
quickly.
was, your festival was my last festival of last year. And even in the midst of it, as the weekend progressed, people were a little more, elbowy and more careful. And a few masks even showed up by the end. So.
It really started with the kind of are we gonna, oh, let's hug. And then by the end, it was like, oh, no, we're not, I'm not really hugging anymore. So we looked at what an online fest was and how they worked and what people were doing. And I mean, full kudos to the fest that pivoted quickly. The April fest that managed to pull off an online fest, that's incredible. I mean, it really is amazing. But also what we saw was that, the heart of True False is community, right? We are a fest about building community, about building a local community and a filmmaker community. And I did not feel that happening online. And the online festivals that I attended, I felt like I was a distracted viewer. I felt like others were distracted viewers. Stats started to come in that said the average person watches 5 minutes or something of a film. I mean, there was just a lot of sampling, going on, and it just felt like this isn't how anybody wants their movie to be watched, and certainly not watched as it's coming into the world. Ten years down the road, filmmakers are fine. Like, whatever, watch my film on iTunes. But we started to build this idea, and I would say for years, True False has been interested, and I personally have been really interested in ideas around immersive experiences and immersive theater and interactivity and how everything from Disney to film festivals to escape rooms build worlds, and kind of pull audiences through those worlds and build narrative, as an experience. And so we took a lot of that research, did our own sort of deep dive where we were really reading esoteric, online treatises about online dating cultures in Israel and stuff like that. And tried to pull out of that what we thought could make something feel like true false. And so thus was born Teleported True False. And it features only six features and four shorts programs. So it's a even smaller than our already small outdoor lineup, and it's culled from that. They are all brand new films. They are all either world or US or international premieres. But the experience really starts with a sort of treasure chest that gets delivered to your doorstep. And it is full of some kind of standard festival swag, but also art pieces and music and things designed specifically to make like an at-home festival happen for you. And that was the idea, is that rather than say we're doing an online festival, we said, well, what if we do an at-home festival? And that's different, right? That's our, that's a very different space than an online space.
Right.
So we invited people to, like, you know, figure out what their pods were, build something in their living room or their backyard. You know, you're going to be able to turn this box into a little ticket booth if you want to, like, have a pretend ticket booth. You know, and so there's goofy things like that, but there's also things which are really, like, we sourced snacks that were appropriate to each one of the films. So each film has a paired snack. And as you open each, there's a, within the larger box, there's a box for every day. And so as you open that box, you're getting that film's snack, and some of the films have scents. So you'll be able to, like, spray a scent around your room that, like, that brings the spirit of the film into your house. And then we're pairing this with some other kind of, like, interactive online experience type stuff, all with the idea of, and it's only going to be about 250 people or pods, you know, 250 right. boxes going out. So all with the idea that, like, let's make a community here. It's not in person and it's not the same as normal True False, but can it be its own thing, which really people are excited to take part in?
So will the people in who are in Colombia have a completely different experience being there?
Yeah, if you're in Colombia and you're able to do the live fest, you know, some folks in Colombia have decided to do the teleported True False, but if you're able to do the live fest, you're in a 116-acre park, you're spending the day listening to music, checking out, like, shops that have set up tents, there's food trucks. We're doing our Campfire Stories event and an event where I make waffles and a giant game of kickball. And then at night you get to watch movies in the park. So it's a much more, like, community kind of, like, park field day kind of vibe if you're here in Colombia.
So what was your, I'm apparently doing teleported True False. Which I'm thankful for, actually, but it's also fascinating because I've been going through these festivals for, you know, 6 months also, or a year now. And it's been various degrees of, I mean, like, the first one I did was the AFI Doc Fest, which was, I thought, great, actually, under the circumstances,
right.
You know, it was, they actually figured it out, and there was some, had the company that had done other ones, and they figured out how to make it very accessible, but it wasn't, as you say, a communal experience, which is a little frustrating.
Right.
And then, you know, it's been interesting. Are the other festivals, because a lot of conversation was being had, certainly over the last year, about festivals cooperating and sharing things and being open to one another, was that increased? Or is that always the case with True False anyway?
We like to think we have good relationships with all festivals. I don't think the industry actually quite responded as everyone talked like they might respond, I will say, to the pandemic. I think in a few cases, it almost felt like, rather than saying, hey, this is an opportunity to, like, reimagine or rework this part of our industry that's not working, mm-hmm. Sometimes it felt like people were almost, like, doubling down on it, you know, like, well, this is what we know and this is what we're doing, or, you know, and look, times are hard for exhibitors, period. And that includes festivals and includes cinemas and includes distributors. So I don't really begrudge anyone making hard decisions or trying to, like, guess what's gonna be best for their film in a year where no one literally knows anything right. about how the year is gonna play out. But yeah, it folks who have been generous and kind and worked with us well in the past were generous and kind and worked with us well. And folks who haven't worked.
Well, I guess, I mean, it's that when you brought up the stat of, you know, people watching movies for 5 or 10 minutes and turning them off or getting distracted or whatever, it's like, that seems horrifying to me. It's like, everybody made the effort to be there and to create the opportunity. Right. And then it's like, you know, I mean, I guess if you paid for the Toronto Film Festival or, you know, you paid $20 a ticket for each screening and you do whatever you want, but.
I you know, look, I'm going to include myself. I just saw a tweet today from someone who was like, I'm grateful for theaters because they make me put my phone away, you know? And, like, for those of us who don't have that, the best self-control, you know, I have found myself at times pulling out my phone on the couch and I would rather be in a theater where I don't do that.
Yeah. It's not just the phone. Like, I mean, it's everything. You're
it's everything. Yeah, of course.
You can go get a drink, you can go to the bathroom, you can do all those things are just, you know, yeah. Whereas if you're at a film festival, you're sitting there holding it in. I remember I watched the Steve James documentary last year. I think you showed 3 or 4 hours of it. And it was just like, I am not going to go to the bathroom. I'm going to watch every minute of it.
Oh, gosh. I've had like, the worst is when you're like, have to do a Q&A. Like, you know, I do this at other festivals sometimes. So I haven't seen the film and I'm watching a movie and I'm like, I know I have to lead a Q&A for this movie. I cannot get up to go to the bathroom. But if I don't go to the bathroom, you know, I don't know what's going to happen. So
it'd be a bad Q&A.
Yeah.
So you're happy with your slate of films?
I'm really happy. I think it represents some of our most ambitious filmmaking we've ever shown. I think it's not a coincidence that it represents some of our highest total of both women and first-time filmmakers. I think these are people who kind of, in this particular year, kind of said, fuck it, we got nothing to lose, and they really went for it. And so—
So you don't feel it was you adjusting to the overall idea of inclusion, but that there were actually better films to pick from, or more films to pick from those groups?
Absolutely better films, yeah, just unquestionably. And it, you know, I think there was a moment early on where I thought, you know, it's outdoors in a park and maybe we kind of like, you know, maybe kind of go easy on people or whatever. And the great films, I mean, like, look, we have really fun titles. We have really fun kind of, you know, popcorn docs that you can like sit back and watch. But we have docs that are like intellectually, visually, creatively ambitious and trying things. And True false audiences are great audiences, and they are great audiences because like they welcome those kind of films. You know, they are not passive kind of like, well, just make me feel good about the world audiences. Yeah. And so I'm excited to share these films, and I think the response is going to be incredible.
What's funny, I think it's my experience of true false in the 1 year I went, because I've been meaning to go for years and never quite got there. But was that even with the serious films, that the filmmakers who were there brought that kind of joy to the room, and that was the experience. Really was the filmmakers and the viewers and the, you know, volunteers and the staff, everybody else. There's a real camaraderie that is built by the festival.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. And you know, we made the decision early on this year that we weren't going to pay to fly in filmmakers. Which is something we normally do. We're normally a very generous fest when it comes to that stuff. Mm-hmm. And we felt like we didn't want to in any way pressure filmmakers to feel like to get on a plane, right? Like if someone wanted to come, that was great. But we sort of felt like, look, they will be the agents, you know, their own agents in this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and I'm really happy with that decision. We're starting now to get the inquiries trickling in and filmmakers. And so, you know, we had expected to do everything on, you know, online in terms of Q&As and stuff like that. And I actually think we may have like, I don't know, 25 to 50% of our filmmakers here in person, which is cool, you know, and which is more than I expected. And that's wonderful.
Well, everybody's hungry to be together again. You know, it's, I've been saying the same thing about distribution in general, which is that, you know, as things moving around, I kind of feel like July 4th weekend is hopefully will be a relatively decent start back into theaters nationally. But you don't know whether it's going to be, you know, will there be enough vaccine around in, you know, for May 4th or for, you know, June 1st, yep, or whatever. And everybody's kind of tiptoeing around because who the hell knows ultimately.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, my mom lives here in town. She's 75. So she's now fully vaccinated, and starting to get together with her friends, but still. And she's like an avid attendee of our Ragtag, our year-round cinema, still hesitant to go back into Ragtag, still sort of feels like, well, you know, there's like a 3% chance that I could get it, you know, whatever. And I think that will shift, but it's going to take maybe a little longer. Yeah. It's not going to be instantaneous. You know, people are not getting that second dose or waiting their 2 weeks and being like, cool, I'm back in it. You know, they're being hesitant. So, which is probably appropriate and will just be something that plays out, I think, in exhibition.
Well, I think it's also a misunderstanding in general by certainly in the media of how desperately somebody needs to see something right now in a theater. You know what I mean? It's like everybody, yeah, wants the experience. A lot of people want the experience back, but there's, you know, I have to go see Black Widow in a theater is not really anything anybody really thinks.
Yeah.
I'd like to see Black Widow in a theater.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure that I have to risk I certainly know I don't have to risk my life. Though I did go see Tenet. But I actually shop theaters and went to a 10:30 show in Costa Mesa where there were only four other people in the theater. So I had felt safe then, but.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that Ragtag has actually been open most of the year, but at 25% capacity, you know, and rarely filling that, rarely hitting that mark. So there have been people who've been watching movies all this last year, you know, in a theater at Ragtag, but it's a very small group. And
when your rooms are not very big.
Right. Yeah. No, it's a 145 seat theater. So it's generally in there with maybe a dozen people. So.
And are they eating popcorn or not eating popcorn?
They're eating popcorn. They're asked to have their masks on when they're not eating popcorn. And there's been a few notes about that, but most of the audiences have been, you know, again, people are in that setup, people are very spread out. So
have you ever moved away from Columbia, or have you always, that has always been your home base through the whole thing?
It's basically been my home base. I went to college in Massachusetts. I split time between Columbia and Washington, D.C. for about 2 years while I was working on a project there. But otherwise, Columbia has been home base for me.
So you founded the festival, co-founded the festival. Yep. And then you left to do the film for a little while, from what I gather.
Yeah, so in...
With AJ?
I was... the film with AJ, I worked on the festival straight through. So wow. I never took a year off the festival for that. In 2018, I left the fest to work on some other film projects. And then this, in May of 2020, when they needed an artistic director and they were in the middle of a pandemic and they weren't sure what kind of festival they would do in 2021, they asked me if I would come back. So I'm actually back at the fest in a 1 year interim artistic director role.
And it sounds like it's a unique year in that this might be completely satisfying to have done this 1 year.
Totally. I am happy to have done it. It's been hard, but also really satisfying. I look forward to helping, helping them like find the next artistic director and moving on with some projects that I'm excited to move on to. So
as you give up power, as it were, or control of things, has that been good for you? Has it been interesting? I mean, obviously different people have different opinions about what to do about this or that.
It's been great. I've been a real believer, honestly, from pretty early in the fest life that if you build something and it's not sustainable without you, then you didn't really build it right. And so it has been a goal of mine from day one to make something that I could step away from. You know, it's like building something out of like, you know, Lincoln Logs or something, right? If you step back and it stands on its own, then you actually built it. If it just falls over because you're not there, I don't know, what was that?
So you, and I assume you pay close attention to what's going on ultimately. You know what decisions are made and what changes are happening and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I'm they're now my bosses, but I work closely with there's three leaders of the organization, kind of three co-EDs, and yeah, they have a vision, and I don't always agree with their vision. And if they ask my opinion, I give them my opinion, and if they don't ask my opinion, I trust that they're going to figure it out. So
that sounds like part of the pleasure of it for you.
Yeah, very much so. I mean, probably the biggest pleasure for me this year has been, you know, I'm working alongside two programmers, Amir George and Angela Catalano. Amir's been, this is his, I think, gosh, third or fourth year at the fest? Third year, I think. And Angela's done stuff with the fest before, but her first year as a programmer. And it's just been a joy to program with them. I mean, they're just like both really top-notch programmers. They have really great and interesting ways of thinking about movies. They've been really the programmers because I've spent so much time working on like, how do we build out safe venues in a park and stuff like that. And so they've brought films to me and just said, hey, we like this one. And I just, you know, of course we've disagreed on films from time to time, but like every time they've like talked about or written about a film and I've read it, I've thought, oh yeah, that's really on point. So,
and how much has the flow in terms of the films changed? Has it been felt different this year? Obviously, you're working with a smaller group of films, but does it feel like people are holding and being more careful or waiting? Or
yeah, I mean, I've had a number of conversations with film teams about what to do and what the right choice for them is, and some of those have decided that True/False was the right choice, and some of them have decided it wasn't. You know, and I. I guess I really pride myself a little bit on, when I talk to filmmakers, I try to be as objective as possible. And of course, I'm talking to them as a representative of a festival, and the festival is, you know, wants to show their film, or sometimes doesn't want to show their film. But you know, I'm representing True False, but I just feel like it's in the spirit of True False to try to really think about like what's best for a film, you know, and let that be our guide. And so there's one, you know, one film immediately leaps to mind that like I let go of, and it hurt, but it was also like, I knew the best path for that film was not at True False. So.
Well, it's funny because you guys having Ragtag from the beginning really are unlike a lot of the other festivals that have invested in cinemas in the last 5 years or 8 years or whatever it's been. Many of whom have suffered for the choice, but for all different reasons. But it seems like this is really a year long, as opposed to an event that ends. Maybe it'll feel a little more like that for you this year, but it seems like it has more of a year long, all year long energy to it that culminates in, you know, a nice party, but another party.
Yeah, they're really different energies, you know, and there's one of our projects, honestly, of the last few years has been bringing together the Fest and cinema staff. Cause for a while, you know, we had them both, but they were really separate staffs. And it's been really good to bring them together, but it's very, you know, it's very clear that there's like, there's a different energy, right? You know, like doing something 360 days a year, you have to be just like steady and keeping with it and keeping at it. And, you know, no one film or one event really looms so large because you're looking ahead to like 12 more events that month, you know?
Right.
And the Fest, you get to do this big concentrated like explosion. So yeah, it's very different flows, but I think especially this year, it's been cool. You know, Ted Rogers is the programmer of the cinema, and he's had to get really creative. And we've been doing outdoor series, you know, partnering with the local brew pub, working with the local parks and recreation department, you know, trying to figure out all the ways that we can screen movies safely and in a way that's fun.
What's interesting is the Columbia of it all is different. I mean, there are a lot of festivals that are destination festivals, but they do tend to eat the entire town. And even though this has a big footprint that weekend, you know, last year's college basketball, I think, was was going on, and that was like the mania, and the kids were all focused on that and not on a film festival.
Yep.
So is that the good part? Is that the...
I love the size of Columbia and doing a festival in a town this size. I think you've hit exactly on it. I think, you know, that you're unsurprisingly astute about that, but like it's, you know, it's not a Park City or a Telluride where we are this giant thing that just takes over and people like sort of like it or lump it, you know, and put up with it. Mm-hmm. And it's not a New York City where like 10 different things are happening at the same time. And, you know, who cares? It's just like we are the focus, and for part of the town, we are the focus, you know, we are the best weekend of the year. And for parts of the town, they barely know a film festival happens in the town, mm-hmm. you know? And that's good. Like, you know, it gives us new audiences to reach. Like it gives us a dynamism and a size that doesn't feel just like stifling, but it still feels like we're an important part of the community.
Well, how would you just, I mean, it's, I am of the feeling that festivals are evolving quickly in terms of their value to the business side and the industry. And that drove a lot of it for a long time. And that as streaming has become so dominant, particularly in documentaries, that it's getting harder, but there is something still valuable and beautiful about the gathering. So, I mean, is that what, is True False bigger than the issue of theatrical and streaming and all that, do you think? Or separate from?
Yeah, I think, you know, I you know, we just had a conversation today with a large distributor. About a new doc they have and a doc that there was a lot of attention on, and they saw value in what we could do with them. You know, we were obviously like coming to them being like, we really want love this movie. We want to show this movie, please. But they saw value, like, you know, and they saw the things they could do with our communities. They saw things they could do, you know, for their director in terms of a live event, how a festival positions a film and a director. We've seen that over the years with True False, where like, you know, directors know that like it's special to be at True False. Even in a normal year, we don't show very many movies.
Right.
And so I think those things all, those are all good things. And I, you know, look, we, I know we agree on like the power of a community, of a communal experience in a dark cinema is a powerful thing. It just is, you know, it's practically magic, I think. And that matters, and that's not going to change. And streaming is not going to change that.
Well, I think there's something also beautiful about the experience for the filmmaker. And I think sometimes, you know, it was the way with Telluride. Telluride has now become so much, that so much of the focus has kind of shifted to Oscar season that it's weirded it out a little. But there's something about you know, it's like the studios, all that they want to distribute the movie, they want to make the biggest audience. But part of it is like, let's take it, spend some money and take some time to make the filmmaker happy, or let the filmmaker be happy. And it's almost like it's a period where they can are convinced that they're actually still filmmakers and not just pushing out product, which is kind of great.
You know, I volunteer at Telluride every year, and I specifically like introduce movies at one of the venues. And because of my job, I have stood with a lot of directors right before the premiere of their movie. And they are almost never, you know, on their phone reading the trades or whatever. Right. They are like looking around the room and looking at the audience and whispering to their friend and like, look how full the room is, you know, and pacing nervously and maybe calling their husband or wife or girlfriend or boyfriend, you know, like they are there. And you're exactly right. Like there's something really special about that. And I think that, you know, pretty early on we were, I think saw what it meant to kind of do like value added exhibition, you know, mm-hmm. And we knew pretty quickly that like, hey, just showing movies isn't necessarily going to be the ticket when it's a movie no one's heard of, or the cast no one's heard of, or director no one's heard of. And so from the very, very first screenings we did, we had like a musician playing beforehand, and we did like funny giveaways on stage, and we tried to do a Q&A if we could. And, you know, you build an event, and you build an event that is unique and unreproducible, and people will always want to come to those events when they're good.
Yeah. When you, and it is almost solely in your memory when you take it away with you, you know?
Exactly. Like, yeah.
Nobody else is gonna, I mean, was it, I don't remember what you call it, the thing where the, like the game show that you do in the
Give me truth. Yeah.
Give me truth. It's not like nobody, there's nothing else like it. And even if there was something else like it, there would not be that combination of people at that moment, you know, where you're having this live theater experience that's connected to something you're already having experience with. It's kind of fantastic and singular. And Telluride, certainly, you know, the filmmakers who dive into it, the funny thing is it's the Oscar thing, you know, there are now people who just kind of like stay in their very fancy hotel on the hill and then come down and, you know, aren't as participating. But then you have Guillermo del Toro, you know, telling the midnight crowd to meet him for coffee at 7 a.m. and having 30 people show up and do that. And that's the kind, you see that at True False also. I mean, I saw filmmakers arguing with people in coffee shops about their movie. Like, where else is that gonna happen?
Yeah.
You know, nobody has the time for that at Sundance, unfortunately.
Right.
You know, it's everybody's on their treadmill, but it's a lovely thing, you know. It's more than a film festival. It's Thank a life you. Festival. do you have planning for yourself? Do you think 5 years from now I want to be doing this or that, or you just kind of go in with the flow?
I think I'm going to go with it a bit. I mean, I have like I have wanted to be and been working to be a filmmaker for a number of years, and you know, and making stuff along the way. But there are definitely like, you know, I feel like I have a bottleneck of projects that between working on the fest and being in a pandemic, you know, got shelved for the last year. So I'm pretty excited to come out of the gate this summer and just start trying to make stuff happen. And exactly that looks like, I'm not sure, but that's where I'm going to be for the foreseeable future.
And does one actually have to move out of a small town to do that anymore? Or is it the world now small enough that you can show up and shoot somewhere, but come home?
I think it's small enough. I mean, it's, we'll see, you know, there are probably doc projects that would have once been sort of possible, even from a small town. Mm-hmm. But like, I have a 4-year-old now, and maybe I don't want to like immerse myself somewhere for, you know, a year straight or something like that. Yeah. But I think there's a lot of projects, doc and fiction, that are very possible from here. And certainly we are. This year has been like, you know, proof positive for anyone who wasn't there yet that we can do our jobs from various places. So.
Well, Aaron Morris was directing from his house in another city. And, you know, he was doing commercials that way, actually. So he was able to make quite his normal good living. I don't know how it affected his doc releases this year, but, you know, there are a lot of filmmakers who are doing that these days.
Yeah.
From a
distance. Yeah, that's wild.
Yes, it is.
I'm available for 7-figure commercial hires at a distance. So, you know.
Well, the new thing is now this Clubhouse thing where, you know, Tony K has right. become the king of Clubhouse. I don't know if you're on there yet, but.
I'm on there. I didn't know Tony K was doing.
Tony K is everywhere.
Clubhouse. Interesting.
Talking about his history, talking about, you know, interrupting rooms because people all kind of revere him, or, you know, like, oh, it's Tony K. And then he starts talking and, you know, he'll take up 30 minutes saying hello. It's
wow.
It's very funny. But he's like, I see him on my, if I'm looking at the thing, he's in that room, he's in that room, that room. It's very impressive.
Wow.
But it's all, there are also communities though that are being created, which are really nice. So it's interesting because there are a lot of people selling NFTs and, you know, timeshares or whatever, trying to scam people a little bit. But in the film community, there are filmmakers who are, you know, young and experienced and who are actually, you know, just talking. And it's been nice. It's been interesting.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, as we all try to figure out how to do things online, which I don't think is going to end, right? I think we're going to keep trying to figure this out. You know, we already build communities online, right? We already build places online where we argue with people and laugh and cry and all of those things and build friendships, you know? So that's not impossible. We just have to like think about how those have been built elsewhere. And then, you know, if we want to make those part of our festivals, replicate those modes. So.
Well, in a weird way, it's almost like a step backwards. And yet considering where we've been, you know, 2 years ago, it's a step forward.
Right.
So it's all, you know, it's the same. I guess it's the old thing about there being only 6 stories.
Right. One of them involves a pandemic, apparently.
Apparently. Well, you know, masks and avoidance of, you know, there are some people who really love social avoidance.
Yeah.
I'm not one of them. I miss everybody. Not as much as my 11-year-old, but I miss everybody. Ugh. And I do miss that big screen. Just that sitting in the dark, disconnected from everything. And it's not just the phone. It's not just peeing. It's like, you know. It is I even think, you know, if I look at like Scorsese's movie last year, I think he cut it differently and shot it differently, knowing it was going to be on Netflix, which I don't consider an insult to Netflix, but he, like, none of the swoosh pans are in the movie. There are a lot of moves that he makes historically that he didn't do. And I think a lot of it was because he was cutting it knowing that that was the ultimate place for it.
That makes perfect sense.
Just different, you know?
Yeah.
Whereas like Peter Jackson did that documentary piece last year, and I feel like he meant it for a big screen, even though eventually he knew it would be in a museum mostly and in a smaller screen. But I think he had that mindset of doing it. And I really think they're different mediums, you know, more than we realize now. But whatever. That's just me rambling, isn't it?
I mean,
Yeah. You were going to say? I didn't want to interrupt you.
No, you had me also thinking about just sort of the – and I'm sure you have these moments too, you know, it rarely happens with movies. It's almost what I'd call like the radio effect or something, but you know, going to a festival sometimes means you just sit down in a theater to watch something and you barely have any idea of what you're watching. And some of those experiences have been the most profound cinema experiences of my life. And so that's something that I'm excited to share with people again. You know, that feeling of just finding yourself in a theater and not being in control, right? Because that's the ur moment of being at home, right? Is all those other distractions, but you also have a remote in your hand and you can stop it or start it. And taking away that power actually is like really important, I think.
Well, the fact that you're curating within the curation for the home experience for this year is fascinating because it actually increases the value of the experience for as a watcher, because you know you're watching the thing that they really want you to watch, as opposed to, you know, a larger program that has other complications and it may have premiered at Sundance and da 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 da. It's like, okay, that's, you know, get in, sit down and pay attention now.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a funny mix of, we've really been talking about like this mix of like encouragement and shame, which we want to like push on people to like we want you to sit and watch and not be distracted and turn off the lights and be present, you know? And we're going to charge you a lot for the experience. So you feel a little bit like, oh, I better make this worth my money. And yeah, we're also going to like encourage you to feel like part of a community as you're doing that. So
when I gather, and actually I didn't know this specifically, but a friend of mine told me that the live experience is really, the amount of it costs is up to the person in a way, on some level, that there's a range and people can pay what they feel comfortable with to be part of that. So it's a whole nother thing.
Yeah. 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 So we, for teleported, for the, I think the in-person stuff is not sliding the scale, but for teleported, we made it a pay what you will.
It's lovely.
Yeah. And it's totally worked as we thought it would work, that the average is much higher than the minimum, but it lets people pay, you know, what they can afford. And that's important right now. So.
Well, I am looking forward to it greatly. It's already on my schedule, my literal schedule.
Awesome.
So I'm looking forward to blocking off that period of time. And hopefully my kid and my wife may participate in full. So that'd be nice.
Cool. Yeah. I think they should. And the, I will say we just put some finishing touches on some of the box items today. You have never gotten a box like this in the mail before. I will say that. So,
well, it's some of the best fun I've had during the festival time has been when my wife has actually watched the movies with me. It's hard to get her to do it. She's at a, you know, busy schedule, but when we share it, I'm like much happier.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I guess that's kind of what I miss also. So. Well, thank you for all of it. And thank you for putting it together and taking your year off to figure us all out and come give us something fun. And I look forward to the whole experience.
Thanks, man. Really appreciate you doing this. And obviously holler if you have any questions whatsoever.
Will do. Thank you so much. Be well.
You too. Take care, David.
Very important this year. Be well. Get those
shots. Stay healthy.
Neuter your pets. Bye.